Hey guys, welcome back to my channel. Welcome back to another video. And today I'm going to be reviewing SteelHeart by Brandon Sanderson. So I've been really excited to get to this book. I'm a huge fan of Sanderson, and I'm a huge fan of superheroes in general too. Honestly, I've read a lot of superhero books. Actually, I don't know if I'd say a lot, but I've read a decent amount. I feel like it's kind of a lot. It kind of depends on how much you read. I would actually love to just go on a rant with you about a lot of superhero books I've read, because there really isn't that many, but not super great. But anyways, rambling aside, I've been wanting to find a superhero book that I really enjoyed, and I was really hoping Sanderson was going to be it. So SteelHeart is definitely super fast-paced, it's extreme, and also really gripping. This book was quite the ride. I knew it was like a superhero book written by literary hero Brandon Sanderson, and I knew that it took more of like a evil villain route, but that's about all I really knew going in. So I was surprised to see that it was actually completely centered on people who didn't have powers. You know, adopting a world where superpowered people, or epics as they're called, were almost exclusively villains and took over cities, like ruling as dictators. So it's actually like a dystopian, which I wasn't really expecting. It was actually very intriguing. David, our main character, describes a lot about, you know, Chicago's transformation to a steel city, and this almost dystopian look at a world ruled by gods was a really unique way to start a superhero story. This becomes more interesting as we get Abraham, who's one of the side characters we pick up later, and his like religion, who actually believes that one day good epics will come to save them all. And this does give me hope that eventually we will be reading from, you know, powered people that are good. So just a quick synopsis about this book for those of you who don't know. This book is centered on David, who as a younger boy, I think around 8 years old, an event that's called the Cataclysm or the Calamity happening to the Earth. And as far as I could really tell, it almost sounds like it's just like a red star in the sky. But the way it's kind of described, it almost sounds like it's constantly in Earth's orbit. I actually can't tell if he ever says it ever goes away, so I'm kind of confused about where it is, if you can see it at all times of the day. But essentially, it's this weird kind of red sun thing. Kind of imagine just like if you know Superman, he gets the power from like the sun. I guess it's kind of like that. It's just like this object, this like red star that ends up like giving a bunch of random people like superpowers. And so one day David, who's 8 years old, is at a bank, and this isn't really spoilers because it's literally the very beginning, but I also think it's in the description, but he's in a bank with his father, and they end up getting attacked by an evil epic. And another epic comes in, known as Steelheart. He's going to be the main antagonist of the book, and he ends up kind of killing David's father. And the reason why he does this is because something that his father does actually ends up making Steelheart bleed, even though he's supposed to be like invulnerable. And because of this, he ends up killing his father, and he kind of goes crazy at this point, and he has also the power to like turn things into steel. That's when he pretty much like takes over the city and like makes everything like all metal. And so we pick up 10 years later, where David basically spent his entire life being an orphan in this city, and he pretty much spent that entire time learning everything he could about epics and the people that actually fight against them and kill epics. And that's where our book picks up. So I grew really interested in their discussion of like what's right and wrong. One of the side characters and David's love interest, Megan, has this point of view that was really compelling. Her thought process to why Steelheart wasn't really that bad. And then kind of a couple chapters later, you get the professor, who's like the leader of the like renegade group. You get his perspective of how they shouldn't really settle for that to be normal. Just because Steelheart isn't as bad as other epics doesn't mean that they should be okay with it. It really shows what kind of like of a tough world they really live in, with no right answers, like no perfect way. And that's like another interesting thing about Megan's point of view, is you slowly start to realize that Steelheart is actually technically better than most of the other cities. Like, he actually tried really hard to make a fairly normal city. Like, a lot of other cities are like destroyed or impoverished or something like that. And he actually has like, you know, a power to the city and stuff like that. He's actually doing fairly well off. So that's why there's like a really interesting struggle dynamic of, should we really be taking this guy out? Just because if they do, it shows a clear sign that normal people can stand up and get rid of epics. You know, do they really want to prove just that point to basically take down like one of the better cities that are, you know, taken over by these evil superpowered people. And one thing I actually really like is that in the book, fairly early on when they discuss this, you know, they're under no false ideology that what they're doing is going to make the city better. They're very aware that what they're about to do is going to ruin the city at first, but it should get better over time, you know, when people start to realize that they can fight back or not rely on the epic or something like that. So like I said, it's really, I wouldn't even say morally gray, but there's definitely a lot of back and forth. It's a lot of hard decisions. And as I said earlier, you know, hard decisions and like no easy answers. So I didn't really realize this at first, but this book actually has a very similar story to Mistborn, one of Sanderson's probably most famous books and most read books. It's about this kind of like ragtag group of revolutionists that work to take down like the big bad guy. I will say though that one defining difference to me is that they are more like mercenaries, and they're kind of killing any epics, and they just happen to be focused on Steelheart because David's vendetta and the fact that, you know, he has this plan that can help destroy one of the biggest bads of them all. I actually watched Elliot Brooks's review. If you don't follow her, she did not a very glowing recommendation. She really didn't like this book, but she did kind of go through a lot of similarities and how close it is to Mistborn. But honestly, like, I didn't really think it was that big of a deal. I just got the whole, like, you know, ragtag group takes down big bad. It's not even that super unique to begin with, you know, Star Wars kind of stuff like that. That's actually how I usually, like, tell people about Mistborn, as I always say. It's kind of like Star Wars, Rebels, go against the Empire kind of stuff like that. So this is relatively, like, similar. So I was actually really intrigued by the mystery of this book the whole way through. The mystery is that you don't know what Steelheart's weakness is. That's actually a big plot point, is that every epic has like a random weakness. And some of them are like super, super random, but I've actually heard that in the later books, it actually does describe that these weaknesses actually do have a specific point. But they talk about stuff like how this guy who has like precognition, but it doesn't work if he's like attracted to the person. So, you know, you put a sexy lady in front of him and he doesn't see like this chick like stabbing him or whatever. So it's a general idea about what they're trying to do is figure out what Steelheart's weakness is. So they're slowly trying to take him down and, you know, figure out a way to draw him out and kill him, all the while still trying to debate on what his weakness actually is. So I've really gotten used to Sanderson creating these really interesting plot reveals and wanting to know what Steelheart's weakness is, plus the secrets brought up during this one part in like a power plant scene, you know, added just so much like my list of curiosities. You know, I was really interested to find out, you know, what would happen, and like really had me on the edge of my seat, because I feel like we were like pages away from something like extremely terrible happening, like everything blowing up in their face, because things are going relatively well. Unfortunately though, there was a lot of foreshadowing of David's plans being risky, and like the professor sort of threatening him if David hurt the team, he would like, you know, he would like do something. And so it really had me like chomping at the bits. But this really wasn't like paid off well. Like there was definitely some negatives here. It wasn't necessarily like a perfect story. Like, so they made this really big point about how often David improvises and how it's kind of a danger, and it literally doesn't come back to kind of like bite them in the butt at all. So moving on to something else is I usually don't care for when they input romances into books like this. You know, in the early stages of the book, I really grew tired of how often David thought and like spoke about Megan, who's like one of the only females in the book. But that honestly kind of really started to turn around like again in part two, where they go to like this power plant. You know, we end up actually talking to her and thinking about how different she is. It's like he talks about how this girl, you know, isn't afraid. I think it's like a lot of girls that he kind of knew, they sort of just like moved on to like, you know, serve people or be part of like, I wouldn't say upper management, but I was like, they just like serve the epics and it's like too scared to kind of like, I guess, do anything. I don't really know. But he talks a lot about how, you know, she's not like this at all. So it's not, I guess it kind of does the whole like, she's not like other girls trope, but I feel like it did it pretty well. It had like an actual good reason. So, you know, it did kind of become tolerable once we kind of knew there was a better reason than just, oh, she's really hot. So though the romance wasn't really my favorite subplot, it still was handled relatively well. And with David having a lot of self-awareness for how ridiculous he's kind of being, because, you know, he does kind of think about her a lot and he knows that he shouldn't be. So it's like, it helps. So some other negatives is really just how sometimes juvenile the whole book kind of came off. There was really hardly any consequences for David. You know, as I said earlier, it seemed to foreshadow that his improvisation would lead to some issues, which it never did. But David's character also seems to know a little bit too much about everything. But again, Sanderson sort of softens this by David's backstory. I mean, like I said, he did spend 10 years after his father's death doing nothing but like training for this and studying it. So he did have like the motivation and the drive to do this. So even if it's not really a favorable way to write a character, the build-up and the backstory, I feel, really supports this. I think my final gripe with David is that he had this odd, like, shtick of basically making bad metaphors. It was kind of really cringy. But again, Sanderson cushioned this with David basically being naive as, like, how to be social. So it, like, kind of made sense. And I've heard some criticism about how I feel like people who are fans of Sanderson like give him a pass because he's Sanderson. I'm not really doing that. Like I said, if a book actually presents these like these cushions or these ways or this way to soften the negatives, I'm going to read that out. You know, if they come up with logical reasons, I can see the breadcrumbs of why this person would act like this. Even if I don't favor it, it really helps like the entire book still remain like solid and like, grounded for me. It's why I still end up giving this like a 4-star book, because he did the work to input the logic into the bad part. So I'm like, okay, like it didn't completely ruin everything for me. Whereas a lot of books, like they don't do that. It's just bad. There's no logic for it. And then like sometimes the book as a whole, the plot or whatever, the ending doesn't follow through to make it good enough to make up for all the other crap. So furthermore, like the last kind of thing negative is that if you read a lot of Sanderson, he usually gets kind of creative with his curse words. So like with Mistborn and Stormlight, it's kind of reasonable because they're sort of like end of the world things, or it's like a whole different mythology. And I don't really remember if Elantris had it. It probably did, but I really don't remember. But in this book, it honestly just seemed like really unnecessary. Like, we're in our world, not a fantasy one. And I didn't listen to the audiobook, so I don't know if these words are even pronounced correctly. But they use words like sparks and schlants a lot, which is really weird. I honestly have no... Like, I don't even know. Like, I don't know what schlants is. I feel like I've heard of that word, but I feel like looking it up. And I really don't know where sparks came from, like, at all. Like, there's nothing really to do with, like, electrical storm or anything like that. I don't know where that came from. I did like Calamity, though. It was, like, fitting considering the world that, like, you know, it grew into. So, like I said, Calamity's that weird star in the sky. So it's kind of, like, I guess sort of a curse word for hell. Although, again, back to Elliot Brooks. She actually made an interesting point to where if something bad happens in our world, we don't, like, randomly change stuff for it to be a bad word. Like, she was saying, like, you know, it's like we're like, ah, Hitler, just because, like, something bad happened or whatever. So it's kind of like... Yeah, that's kind of a good point. So again, the cursing was kind of weird. So honestly, those were most of my negatives. It wasn't anything very major. You know, Sanderson usually always has the background and build up to why things happen the way they do, so you can understand it even if you don't like it. I would say, however, if you're a heavy character-driven reader, you may not like this as much, or at least not favor it. Most of the characters aren't bad, but they just seem to kind of be like backup dressing to David. I think my least favorite is Cody. Which, again, if you've read Sanderson, he kind of comes off as, like, an early attempt at Wit from Stormlight or Wayne from the Mistborn Second Era. I honestly don't remember when he wrote this book, so I guess if it was written before all of this, it would make sense because he hadn't gotten to Wit and Wayne yet. But if it's after those, I would just be kind of surprised. I'm like, you did it so well in those other books, what happened here? His reasons behind why he acted kind of made sense, but his quirks were still, like, really odd. So David overall was still pretty good. You know, I get really tired of these, like, young characters who still win, but, like, show, like, no competence, like, throughout the story. So I actually did enjoy how David, like, theorized and how competent he was at, like, what he did. So I'm really interested to see how he's going to grow, like, going forward. In typical Sanderson fashion, which is honestly has been a phrase that I've been using, like, while reviewing almost all of his books, it usually comes down to the final reveals, the build-up, and the plot twist. So if you haven't read the book, this is kind of where the spoiler talk sort of goes from here. So if you're not interested, you know, leave here, or if you don't really want to read the book and don't care for spoilers, continue. But I definitely always like talking about like the endings and stuff like that because, you know, that's usually what Sanderson is really known for. So first I want to talk about Megan. I had assumed that she hadn't died in the book when she actually did die because she really went out pretty unceremoniously for that. I actually really did assume that she was an epic. the foreshadowing was a little ham-fisted, like, especially like the elevator scene, and then definitely like the motorcycle chase, because David was clearly like, oh, I thought I saw something, or why don't they see me, or stuff like that. It was kind of like really obvious. But actually, I thought it happens, I thought that she was going to be the epic that they actually killed earlier. So I think earlier in the book, it was like this like minor epic that had these illusion powers, and it would have made sense that, you know, that the illusionist just becomes Megan and then goes and shoots like the real Megan, and then she kind of like take over from there. I'm kind of glad they didn't go with that though, because honestly, like, at least the way that they wrote the book, it wouldn't make sense that she like knew the group so well. But again, they did say that she was relatively new, so it would kind of make sense. I actually did not expect her to actually be Firefight, which honestly does seem really obvious now, since I already thought that she was an illusionist, and in the book they're talking about how Firefight was an illusionist. So I'm actually kind of really ashamed that I hadn't like pieced that together until like the final fight, when he like actually started to see her when he thought she was dead. But I think that's just because I didn't really know a lot about their timeline. I didn't realize like how new she was. I didn't realize that. I don't really know how like Firefight would have like gotten to become part of the group. But the second book is called Firefight, so I'm assuming that's when we're going to learn about her. I did think it was interesting, like a nice touch, that her powers faked the Dowser test, which was like something that they scan to see if people are epic or not. And so since she's an illusionist, obviously she could just make the scanner seem like it was a negative. I don't think she can actually like cover sound though, so it'd be kind of interesting if like it also made noises. So if they scanned it and then it beeps, they'd just be like, what the hell? But anyways, overall I think it was pretty interesting. I was hoping that she more faked her death than was actually reincarnated. That was really out of left field, and I didn't as much care for that reveal. I thought that was kind of odd. I like that we didn't get any sort of like reciprocation of like the romance from her in this book. It's clearly going somewhere, but I'm glad it wasn't like revealed all at once and then, you know, she returned it. So she obviously raises some big questions about how them using their power changes them. So I'm really intrigued for that sequel. So my next topic for spoiler discussion is the professor. So I also didn't catch him being an epic at all until like the final fight. But I actually just assumed that he just wore the gloves to make it look like he wasn't an epic. I honestly really did not see him actually being able to give the gifts to them. Again, that's one of those like Sanderson things where it's like, it's talked about, so you're aware that this is a thing of epics giving their powers to other people. So again, it's not like it was like really obvious, but the breadcrumbs are there to where you can be like, oh, well, yeah, that makes sense. Why wouldn't he have done that? Or, yes, that's totally plausible that he could do that. I did think this part was super interesting. When I first kind of realized he was going to be an epic, I thought that he was just one of the epics that were experimented on, and he actually escaped, killing the scientists and taking the technology that they made from him. So I thought they were still on his powers, but that he was experimented on, professors made this stuff, and he got out and took the stuff with him. I almost think that would probably be more interesting than the power giving reveal, but whatever, it's kind of a moot point. I of course didn't bring this up in my non-spoiler, but I did like how this reveal did give us a plot of good epics stopping bad. I of course just couldn't talk about it earlier because then you would know, but it doesn't even really diminish the whole like regular people stopping epics thing, because that's why we have David. I don't know if David's eventually going to be an epic. I feel like that might be too obvious and cliche, and I think Sanderson, I would trust Sanderson to be better than that. But honestly, I do love me a superhero story. I'd love for him to have powers. But again, he kind of does. Like, the professor sharing his powers with him, he technically is a person with powers, so he kind of get both of that, and I kind of like that. And just like with Megan, we have this whole mystery as to what happens to them when they use their powers. I thought that was like the biggest plot twist, because then you realize that these bad people aren't necessarily bad, and that Steelheart's probably a better person than most, because he is, you know, being tempted, or, you know, sees red and uses powers or whatever, but he still made like a really good city. Speaking of which, my last part of spoiler discussion is Steelheart himself. I did not guess the fear as like a weakness power. Like, I was like thinking, and I was just like, I honestly don't know. You know, going back to Elliot Brooks's review, she kind of was just like, oh, I don't really know if I feel like, you know, imagining what it could be, because literally these weaknesses could be anything in the world, which, yeah, technically they could, at least as far as I know in this book. But it's kind of like, I mean, don't you have a little more faith in Sanderson not to make it like anything? It's not like, you know, he's gonna be like, oh, we can only kill him like at 11:38 p.m. or whatever. Like, that's not really a Sanderson move. So, like, I knew that you could have figured it out if you like tried hard enough or thought about it. So anyways, I thought that was actually pretty cool. I liked how it wasn't really obvious and still kept the suspense like the whole book. It's why like I read it so fast. I just needed to know what it was. I heard some people say like they didn't really like this. I know that some people theorized about other ways that they thought it could be. I especially liked it more because literally the whole book sets it up to be this. It's like they talk about how, you know, he's randomly killing people and doing stuff that sounds really crazy so that, you know, you're scared of him, and, you know, he's like getting all these flyers together and creating fake stories about things that he's done, even though he hasn't really done them, to make people scared. It's like, again, with that buildup, that's one of the things I think people kind of got to the end, they're just like, oh, that's so dumb, it's, you know, fear is a weakness, that's really stupid. It's like, I guess it's kind of not super great, but I really liked how he set it up to be there. Like, I liked how Steelheart handled his weakness. But anyways, guys, so that is going to be it for my video. You know, if you guys liked Steelheart or didn't like Steelheart, you know, leave some comments below, you know, discuss some of the opinions that I have, give some of your own. If you're a fellow booktuber and you have your own Steelheart video, you know, leave that link below so I can go and watch that and chat with you there. And that's going to be it for me. So thank you guys so much for watching. Have a good day, and I will see you all next time. Bye, guys.